Professor Laurikainen, the founder of the Finnish Society for Natural Philosophy, held popular seminars in the cellar auditorium of the Department of High Energy Physics on first days in the end of the 70s. The main topic was quantum mechanics and its implications concerning observations versus reality. This is a long story, but I just state that the inspiration for searching a simple structure creating natural process came from these seminars, not from blue sky or thin air. Chaos was an active field of research then and still is, and it offered an interesting possibility for a simple natural process. Michel Feigenbaum showed that period doubling is a universal property of nonlinear dynamical systems. The word universal is important because nothing in nature is truly linear. And so we should be able to discover the period doubling phenomenon at least in the nonlinear gravitational and Coulombic 1 over r potential systems. The aim of this presentation is to illustrate the fundamental role of the period doubling mechanism behind natural processes in creating the structures of the elementary particles, planetary and galactic systems, and others. What is period doubling or frequency halving? Suppose we have an oscillating nonlinear system, for instance, a string of a violin. We analyze the spectrum and we find that there is not only the fundamental frequency, but there are other frequencies which are so-called harmonic frequencies, and they are simply n times the fundamental frequency, where n is 2, 3, 4, 5, etc. These harmonic frequencies are generated instantaneously. Applications can be found, for instance, in radio and laser technologies. In a linear system, there are no harmonic frequencies. It is less widely known that subharmonics may be generated too. The process is called period doubling or frequency halving. Generation of subharmonics is not instantaneous, because a long period cannot be generated within a short period. The subharmonics stabilize or become chaotic in the course of time. We shall use the period doubling phenomenon as a tool in analyzing experimental and observational data. So if our fundamental frequency is 1 kHz, then the period is 1 millisecond. And what period doubling does is that as time goes on, 2 millisecond periods appear in the system if we analyze the spectrum. And then 4 millisecond, 8 millisecond, and so on, subharmonics. This is called the period doubling phenomenon or frequency halving phenomenon. And the period is simply inversely proportional to frequency. Now in the chaos theory, an attractor is a set of numerical values toward which a system tends to evolve given enough time for a variety of starting conditions of the system. System values, for instance period or energy, that get close enough to the attractor values remain close even if slightly disturbed. This means stability. Is there enough time for the attractors to develop? The vast majority of the elementary particles have lifetimes on the order of 10 to minus 20 seconds or less, whereas the planetary systems have evolved for billions of years. The electrons and protons have existed for billions of years too, and they have well-defined intrinsic physical properties. well-defined means that there is a very small uncertainty in the physical properties. Our solar system is likewise very old. Now is 10 to minus 20 seconds long enough for the attractors of the artificial elementary particles to fully develop? An answer will be given later in this presentation. Now some mathematics and equations, sorry for that, but it's necessary in this presentation. If the shortest or the fundamental period of the system is tau naught, then the nth period is simply 2 to the nth times the fundamental. So the subharmonic periods are 2 times the fundamental, 4 times 8 times 16, 32, 64, and so on. So the number of doublings is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and so on. But there is an interesting subset of periods. We find that some of these numbers are power, integer powers of 2 themselves. And this is a very important subset. Namely, if the number of doublings is one of these numbers which are integer powers of 2 themselves, that is n, the number of doublings, is an integer power of 2 itself, then we have what is called superstability. And this is what we will later find out. Period doubling is not a mathematical curiosity, but a real physical phenomenon which has been observed, for instance, in pulsating stars, in our sun, and demonstrated in many experiments. Now the important thing is that period doubling has a direct connection to physics. For instance, energy, it's inversely proportional to period. Wavelength or distance is directly proportional. Temperature, inversely proportional. Magnetic moment, directly proportional. So these relations indicate that period doubling will manifest itself as a halving or doubling behavior in these quantities too. For the fundamental period, we choose the Planck time, tau naught, defined by natural constants h, c, and g, because this gives Planck energy and others, which are process independent. These values are simply determined by these natural constants. As you can see, some of these values are out of this world. For instance, a Planck period is 10 to minus 43 seconds. Nothing in real life is this short. Planck length is 10 to minus 35 meters. For comparison, the diameter of a proton is 10 to minus 15. Planck temperature is 10 to 32 Kelvin. For comparison, the estimated temperature of the sun's core is 10 to the 6th or 10 to the 7th Kelvins. It is now possible to compare the measured values of different quantities, for instance, energies, to the corresponding Planck reference using equation 4. Just calculate the ratio. If the number of period doublings is an integer, then period doubling may be taking place. So put, for instance, Q equal to 1 MeV, which is the rest energy of electron-positron pair, and Planck energy here, and see what is the value of n, whether there is period doubling or not. Figure 1 shows ratios of 49 commensurate quantities, including rest energies of the elementary particles, semi-major axes of the orbits of the planets, etc. This was made in the 80s and published in 1990. Of course, the magnitude of the ratio depends on what is compared. It turned out that the majority of the ratios were something else than integer powers of 2. However, the decimal part of n, the number of period doublings, tells how close the exponent is to an integer value. For instance, 63.98 and 64.01 are close to 64. The decimal parts seem to form 3 groups. So out of these 49 ratios, about 1/3 was such a form that the ratio was 2 to an integer 0.00. 1/3 of the form 2 to integer 0.33. And the third column here is ratios of 2 to an integer 0.66. So the ratios were of the form 2 raised to integer over 3, which means that the 49 calculated ratios are cube roots of an integer power of 2. Now, what does this mean? The corresponding periods for our finding means that the nth period is simply 2 to the n over 3 times the fundamental period. Now, cubing both sides, we find that the nth cube is 2 to the nth times the fundamental cube. So, it is the volume that doubles in the period space. Volume means that the 49 systems we analyzed have 3 internal periods or degrees of freedom, or dimension of the period space, if you like. So we have the fundamental cube, the Planck cube here. As time goes on, the volume doubles, and finally we have the nth cube, which is 2 to the nth times the fundamental cube. This is the symmetric doubling case. Degree of freedom means that the 3 periods are independent, and that the number of doublings can be different for each period. So the total number of period doublings is I plus j plus k, where these numbers are integers too. So now what we have is a straight parallelepiped. In the general case, there is different number of doublings for each period. The perceived period is then given by the cube root of 7. It's this equation 8. We simply take the cube root as before. Now the number of doublings is a sum of 3 numbers of doubling. And this equation 8 can be converted into other quantities, for instance, energy, as mentioned before. In terms of energy, equation 8 becomes equation 9, or what we perceive is 2 to minus I plus j plus k over 3 times the Planck energy. Integers I, j and k represent the number of energy halvings from the Planck energy in the 3 degrees of freedom. Rotation and vibration are well established phenomena in nuclear, atomic and molecular physics. Even the Earth vibrates in addition to rotation after an earthquake. We assume that rotation and vibration are ubiquitous phenomena and that rotation and vibration can be taken as internal degrees of freedom of the system, for instance, like in molecules. It was Niels Bohr's idea that a wave can close or localize itself into a circle such that the circumference of the circle is in an integer multiple of half a wavelength. The structure is called a ring resonator, and the energy levels of a hydrogen atom were explained for the first time. A ring resonator describes energy in rotational motion. The Fabry-Perot interferometer is a linear resonator where an integer number of half waves are trapped between two parallel mirrors. This type of an interferometer describes energy in linear or vibrational motion. It is plausible to assume that the elementary particles have rotational and vibrational energy levels too. To find out whether this is so, we include a factor of pi in our energy equation for particle rest energy analysis, because the ratio of the circumference of a circle to the diameter is pi. So for 1 degree of freedom we get, we have this normal energy path, and then there is the Rotwib indicator, which is either 0 or pi or 1 over pi. Now the 3D form of energy is simply a product of three of these individual energies. And finally we get equation 12, what represents the perceived energy. It is pi to the a over 3 times 2 to the minus n over 3 times the Planck energy. And this is the cube root that we need for returning the volume into a scalar value. A system with 4 degrees of freedom can be described using the same formalism. Why 4 degrees of freedom? Isn't 3 enough? Our world is three-dimensional. Now the natural reference for the elementary charge is the Planck charge, Q naught, which is defined as a square root of 4 pi epsilon naught hc, where epsilon naught is not the gravitational constant, but the permittivity of vacuum. So now we have a different set of natural constants here. And because we are interested in ratios, let's calculate the ratio of e squared to q naught squared, therefore at Coulomb energy is proportional to charge squared. And what we get is the ratio is 2 to minus 9.7499, which is 2 to 9 and 3 quarters. Now the number 4 here tells that we have a fourth root, that there is 4 degrees of freedom. So the intrinsic Coulomb energy system of the elementary charge has 4 degrees of freedom. The fourth root also brings about the plus minus polarity for electricity. The cube root means monopole for mass. The system is superstable because m equal to 39 is sum of integer powers of 2 according to the stability rule. Down here we remember the exponent is a power of 2 itself, and we find that the ratio is 2 to the 0th, 2 to the 1st, 2 to the 2nd, and 2 to the 5th. Later we find that this is connected to the rest energy of the electron-positron pair. But anyway, the elementary charge is stable. Enough time for the attractors to develop. Suppose an initially 3D plus 4D or 7D system, that is Mars with electric charge, has enough time to evolve. The corresponding mass part and the electromagnetic part become fully developed independently, and the system becomes a combination of the 3D and 4D parts. So what we perceive is possibly some rotation and vibration. Then there is the 3D mass part, the cube root. Then some rotation and vibration in the EM part and the energy part, the period doubling part. Now you find that we have here E sub double naught. What is that? Now E sub double naught is what I call now is the generalized Planck energy. which takes into account the Planckian Coulomb energy and not only the conventional Planck mass energy. Therefore, the generalized Planck energy is larger than the Planck energy by the ratio of the Planck charge to the elementary charge squared. But this later we'll see that this allows us to analyze particles, divide the mass part and electromagnetic part and see what their structure is. Not enough time for the attractors or the long periods, the subharmonics, to develop. For the short-lived elementary particles, there may not be enough time for the attractors of the 3D and 4D parts of the particle structure to fully develop. The period space volume of the structure can be now described by a nonlinear system with 7 degrees of freedom because they have not separated yet. Then the energy levels are simply, the energy part is 2 to the minus n over 7. This is the 7th root times the generalized Planck energy. And here we have the Rotwip indicators for the mass part and the EM part, if there is rotation and vibration. Now equation 17, this here, describes a system with 3 independent phase spaces, namely the period space, the Rotwip space for the mass system, and the 4D Rotwip space for the electromagnetic system. Let's analyze the short-lived particles where there is not enough time for the attractors to develop. The Large Hadron Collider in CERN is one of the biggest, and I forgot to write down that it's also the most expensive and complicated device ever built by man. Protons travel there in opposite directions at nearly the speed of light, and their collisional energy is 14 tera electron volts. Electron volts is an unit of energy used by physicists. But for comparison, the proton rest energy is 1,000th of the collisional energy of the protons. The device itself is a vacuum tube. Its circumference is 27 kilometers, so it is a huge thing. And you can hardly see here, here is one of the researchers. So, most artificially created elementary particles are extremely short-lived. Their lifetime is on the order of 10 to minus 23 to 10 to minus 19 seconds. This may be too short a time for the particles to obtain stable 3D and 4D parts, which is manifested by the wide Bright-Wigner distributions. Bright-Wigner width means essentially the width of a resonance curve. Therefore, we consider these particles as 3D plus 4D, that is 7D degree of freedom, flashes, rapid flashes of energy, and apply our equation 17, which is here written as equation 18. And what do we get? The total number n of period doublings can be solved for from our energy equation if the particle rest energy is known. The number of doublings is simply this ratio of the logarithms. Now I have combined the Rotwib indicators to one number, it's the lowercase n here, power of pi. Because the Rotwip mode, or the A and B, is not known a priori, we calculate the n values for all different possible modes from n equal to minus 2 to n equal to plus 2 for each particle, integer ends are colored and written in a column in downwards growing order. So what we do is we write the rest energies of particles here. This is the epsilon particle. Then we calculate the number of doublings for all possible Rotweb states, which we don't know beforehand. So this row here is quite long, and in every cell there is the corresponding number of doublings. Then we find out that one of those numbers is an integer. We color that and calculate all the rest of the numbers and do the same. Pick up the integer numbers and color it. So this is a huge table. There are more than 8,000 cells in this table. Then we order the total number of doublings in downwards ascending order. And what follows from this? I calculated the integer number of period doublings for the baryons. They are shown here in ascending order from equation 19, which is our energy equation. The baryons are, loosely speaking, heavy protons and neutrons. So they belong to the proton-neutron family. And what happens here that the particles seem to form three groups? Because in this period doubling scenario, we don't have any names for these groups. I have used the names used by people who have the standard model of the elementary particles. But otherwise, the concepts used in this analysis have nothing to do with the concepts of the standard model. But I call these, according to standard models, these particles are the bottom particles. These are the so-called charmed particles, and these are the strange and non-flavored particles. But particles clearly split into three groups according to this period doubling analysis. And each particle has its characteristic number of period doublings and Rotweb state. The nucleons are kind of a ground state particles because A and B is both zero. But this is an interesting picture because we have no theory here. This table includes the rest energies of the baryons. Here are the omega particles, xi, sigma, delta, lambda, and the nucleons. And I have simply made a scatter plot of these energies. And we can see that part of the particles have rest energies little less than 6,000. Then there is another group little less than 3,000. And another group around 1,500 MeV. So this clearly indicates that there is a doubling or halving process going on. And this is just a plot, no theory here. What is jiggling or ripples here are, they are due to the Rotweb states of the particles. Now the same calculation for the mesons. The blue shades here are so-called double bottom mesons. Then there are the bottom mesons, charmed mesons, charmed strange, and strange and light unflavored. But we can see that the mesons have exactly the similar behavior as what we already had for the baryons. There are two interesting particles. They are called gauge bosons in the standard model, mediating the weak force. They are very heavy. Their rest mass is about 90 times that of the proton. They seem to form a group here of their own. Now you may ask, where is the Higgs particle, the God particle? Well, it's here. It seems to form a group of its own. And now there are indications that even heavier particles exist. And I would like to forecast that they go somewhere here and form a group of their own. There are some outliers here, as you can see. They have special names in the standard models. They are pseudoscalar and so-called vector mesons. So period doubling seems to organize the artificial elementary particles. How about the electron-positron pair? There is enough time for the attractors to develop. Why I go to this, the reason is that the rest energy, electric charge, and magnetic moment of the electron and positron are normally taken as natural constants. They are not normally explained in any way. Electron-positron pair creation is the fundamental process for converting energy into matter. According to the present understanding, these particles are stable over billions of years, which suggests superstability according to the theory of nonlinear dynamical systems. So what we do is, again, take the ratio. This 1 MeV is the rest energy of the pair, and this is the Planck mass energy. And the ratio seems to be 2 to minus 74.667. And this 2/3 clearly belongs to the first group of the systems. The total number of period doublings is very close to 2 to 4 divided by 3. Now, the total number of period doublings is the sum of I, j, and k, which are integers. So we should be able to split 2 to 4 into the sum of 4 numbers, which are powers of 2 themselves. And we find that 2 to 4 is 32 plus 64 plus 128, which is 2 to the 5th, 6th, and 7th. Which means that the structure of the electron-positron pair is superstable. Otherwise, we would not exist as we are. The superstability of the pair means that electrons and positrons always coexist. If so, where are the positrons or the positive elementary charge? This is an interesting question. Where are the positrons hiding? Now, with exactly 224 period doublings, we can calculate the rest energy of the EP pair, and this is what we get, 1.021, which represents an inaccuracy of 1 kilo electron volt. We can now write down the combined superstable structure of the electron-positron pair. This is the mass part, 2 to the 5th, 6th, and 7th, it's superstable, and we find that the 4D part represents the Coulomb energy of the elementary charge. The electron has a very large magnetic moment, actually 658 times that of the proton. And let's take a look at that too. Magnetic moment mu is defined as a current loop, where the magnetic moment is current times the area of the loop. Take copper wire, make a loop, connect it to a battery, current starts flowing. The magnetic moment of the loop is current times the area of the loop. Moment means that it tends to turn in a magnetic field. The Planck loop serves as a natural reference, where the loop circumference is the Planck length, and the current, the elementary charge, divided by the Planck period. And equation 22 is what we get for the Planck scale reference magnetic moment. Now take the ratio again. The EPP magnetic moment is 4.6 times 10 to minus 24 ampere meter squared. That's half of the electrons because the pair energy is twice. And the magnetic moment becomes EP magnetic moment is 2 to plus 2 to the 5th, 6th and 7th times our reference. So the number of period doublings in the EP pair, EP pair rest energy is the same as the number of period doublings with the magnetic moment. Now we can calculate the magnetic moment and we find that the difference is 0.061 as compared to the NIST value. So for every electron-positron pair, every process step halves the energy and doubles the magnetic moment because of the number of doubling is the same. How about the proton? Let's use again our energy equation 17, put in numbers. This number here is the proton rest energy. This is the generalized Planck energy, which includes the Coulomb bath. What we find is that this is pi to the zero times 2 to minus 192 over 3. Now here we have pi to minus 2 over 4 times 2 to minus 39 over 4, which can be written in a more illustrative form, which is here. We see that the mass part or the 3D part is super stable, 2 to the 6th, 6th and 6th, which means that it is symmetric. Proton is a cube or a sphere, if you like. And the 4D part seems to be Coulomb energy. But now, out of the 4 degrees of freedom, 2 are vibrational. The proton has magnetic moment 2, and because of the 2 vibrational or linear modes in the 4D EM part, we define the reference loop such that the loop diameter is half of the Planck length corresponding to the ground state of a particle in a box in quantum mechanics. And what we get is this equation 27. This is a slightly different reference than what we were using with the electron-positron pair. Anyway, the ratio becomes 2 to plus 64 or 2 to the 6th, which tells us that this is a superstable structure. We can calculate also the theoretical value for the proton magnetic moment, and it differs from the NIST value by 0.07. So NIST is the National Institute for Science and Technology, and these are so-called official values that they publish. How about the neutron? It's kind of a funny particle. It is electrically neutral, but it has a rather large magnetic moment. Now the scattering experiments have shown that the neutron has a negative surface and it is positive inside. So we can model neutron's magnetic moment using 2 loops, one negative and one positive. Because the proton and neutron sizes are essentially equal, and we simply assume that the magnitude of the magnetic moment caused by the negative surface is the same as the proton's magnetic moment, but of opposite sign. The magnetic moment mu I of the inner loop is obviously smaller and positive. With these assumptions, we can write that the neutron magnetic moment is minus proton magnetic moment plus the magnetic moment of the inner, so far unknown, loop. But we can solve for the magnetic moment of the inner loop, and it becomes 4.4 times 10 to the minus 27th ampere meter squared. And it belongs to the period doubling system because the ratio, this is now our Planck scale reference, is 2 to plus 63 plus 3. So this belongs to the first family in our distribution that we showed in the beginning of my talk. So neutron is also a period doubling system, both energy and magnetic moment. Now if we insert the calculated magnetic moment into our previous equation, we get the theoretical value for the neutron magnetic moment, which is practically the same as the measured value. Antiprotons can be artificially manufactured, but they are not found in nature. Therefore, some property of the neutron must possess the nuclear anti-property. This analysis suggests that the negative surface magnetic moment of the neutron is the required anti-property, fully cancelling the proton magnetic moment, and magnetic binding between these particles follows too. Yeah, this is the deuteron, but let's skip it. Now, this presentation may have been rather boring up to now. Plenty of elementary particles, plenty of equations and explaining. Why this much about the method and the elementary particles? The reason is that to our knowledge, there is no other theoretical scenario enabling the calculation of the intrinsic properties of the elementary particles to great accuracy and simultaneously explaining the stability of the basic particles. This refers to the chaos theory. We hope that the following will be more interesting because it may explain the unexplained too. The cosmic microwave background radiation. As we heard yesterday, Professor Narlikar mentioned that even before Penzias and Wilson, this was predicted and discovered, but sorry, I forgot the name of the researcher. Anyway, officially, Penzias and Wilson discovered the background microwave radiation in 1964, and they were awarded Nobel Prize in 1978. This is electromagnetic radiation as if there were transmitters all over the space. And the power spectrum is exactly the same as that of a black body whose temperature is 2.73 kelvins. So it is now interesting to calculate a ratio again. Here is the Planck temperature, and this is the observed black body temperature. The ratio is 2 to -106.68. This is again 2/3, so this ratio belongs to the electron group. And we find that this is superstable, 2 to -2 to the 6th, 7th, and 7th. And this relates to the EP pair, the ratio is 2 to -2 to the 5th. How about the Big Bang then? If this radiation is related to the system of electrons and positrons, how can it have anything to do with the cooling universe? These are fixed ratios. Well, let's go to hydrogen. There is a hydrogen sky. The sky would look like this if we could see 21 centimeter wavelength light. This bright strip here is our Milky Way, and there are huge glowing filaments of hydrogen that transmit 21 centimeter wavelength. This is one example of the radio eye. This is the Effelsberg 100 meter radio telescope. Hydrogen atom is quite a marvelous thing. Its radius is 10^-11 meters, yet it can radiate 0.2 meters wavelength radiation. The atom is far too small to be able to radiate 21 centimeter wavelength. Classical or quantum physics cannot explain this. But I would like to say that Tuomas Untola's dynamic universe has a very elegant and nice explanation for this radiation from this small atom. Now, again, the ratios are interesting. How does 21 centimeter relate to the Planck length? Now the ratio is 2 to 112. Now let's split it into the three parts and we find that this is 2 to the 4th, 6th and 8th. Again, a superstable structure related to the EB pair. Now the 21 centimeter corresponds to 5.9 microelectron volts, and the relation to the electron positron pair is again ratio of energies. This is the radiation energy, this is the EB pair, and this is 2 to the minus 2 to the 4th, 5th, and 6th over 3. Showing that the 21 centimeter radiation or the structure of this energy system is directly related to the electron-positron pair. What could possibly the sunspot cycle to do with period doubling on electrons and positrons? Well, everybody knows that there is a 11-year sunspot cycle. The sun is very quiet, then it becomes wild. Here it's wildest, and then it gradually calms down again, and the cycle is about 11 years. Now, the radio emission from the sun at a wavelength of 10.7 centimeters, often called the 10 centimeter flux, has been found to correlate well with the sunspot number. These crosses here are the actual sunspot numbers, and the solid line is the 10 centimeter flux. The radio flux at 10.7 centimeters can be measured relatively easily and quickly, and has replaced the sunspot number as an index of solar activity for many purposes. But what do we find? We note that 10.7 centimeters is half of the hydrogen's 21 centimeter wavelength, suggesting that the sunspot cycle, hydrogen and electron-positron pair are connected. Actually, if we think of it, this is not a surprise, because after all, the sun is hydrogen, and it shows all the properties of hydrogen. How about the solar system? Can we calculate the orbits and orbital velocities? Equations for the circumference of the orbit and orbital velocity are here. These have been published before. And you can see that these relations are universal. There is no reference to the sun. L naught is the Planck length. C is the speed of light. And these are the terms that double or half these quantities. Now, given enough time, the initial dust and gas around the protosun accumulate into orbits, which are attractors, determined by the period doubling process. Note that the orbital velocities of the planets are given by consequent integers here, 38, 39, and so on, up till 84. And this is a comparison of the observed orbits and those calculated from these two relations. Now here is one interesting thing. There is an empty allowed orbit, as if a planet were missing there. We can see that Jupiter has been pulled towards the empty orbit as if there had been a strong interaction sometime in the past, and as a consequence, planet 44 has been thrown out of the system. There is also a planet missing from the other side of the Jupiter. There is the asteroid belt. So if we do some guesswork, this means that Jupiter has been hustling around here. Well, there is a more detailed analysis published earlier. But as you see, the orbits are not formed by any random numbers, but consequent integers. Every orbit is filled, except orbit 44. Now we go to the galaxy redshifts and quantization. I added an extra slide here because Professor Barber yesterday asked about the quantization of the galaxy redshifts. So what Professor Tift did, he wanted to be an astronomer, and he started to measure the redshifts of galaxy pairs. Stars are often binaries, and there are hundreds of galaxy binaries. He measured the redshifts of the components of a binary, plotted them down, measured, plotted the values, and he found out that the redshift clump around certain velocity values if redshift is interpreted as velocity. So the redshift difference of the pair seems to be quantized. This is the redshift quantization. And the redshifts, or the velocities, seem to group around 36 kilometers per second, 72, 144. This was in the 70s. Now we know that there are many more redshifts that belong in these groups. He then started to measure redshifts of single galaxies. And what we found is that those redshifts belonged to these groups too. But because he was a careful experimenter and observer, he returned to the redshifts he had measured earlier, 10 years, 20 years before. To his surprise, he found out that the redshift of some galaxies had changed within 10, 20 years. They had become redder by one redshift quantum. Now, if we think of the size of the galaxies, they are typically 100,000 light years. So no signal can traverse across the whole galaxy in 20 years. So something happens which deals with the whole galaxy simultaneously. And this is which calls for the fourth dimension and Tuomas Untola's theory. So let's see how period doubling is related here. These are again our ratios. We find that they are integer powers of 2, which tells us that this is a period doubling energy system in 3 internal degrees of freedom. Note that the velocity is obtained from the same equation which was used in the analysis of the solar system, pointing to a common universal mechanism. In Professor Tift's opinion, the quantized redshift does not mean quantized recessional velocity. This is an intrinsic property of the galaxies. Here is a couple of pictures of Professor Tift's publications. These curves are the observations. Here we have power. Power means the number of galaxies with redshift within a given interval. And the straight lines here are the theoretical values that come from these equations. As you can see, now P here means period, but it's the same as velocity. And this is what we originally had already with the solar system. But what Professor Tift found that the total number of period doublings depends on the morphology of the galaxies. Therefore, he was able to split the total number of period doublings into families according to the morphology. What he found was that we need the ninth root to describe the intermediate redshifts when the galaxy is in changing its redshift. There seems to be fine structure. Now Professor Tift says that three studies have been made to look for power inconsistent with these equations. No deviations have been detected so far. Now, do we have any theory for period doubling? Both gravitational and Coulomb potentials are 1 over r non-linear, and it is possible to derive a differential equation in period space. So this is entirely different from space-time. We have no time here. These are structures. And we obtain a differential equation like this. We are not going into any detail. Here is the Kepler's third law. Radius cubed has function of period double. And we find that the volume doubles nicely to 4, 8, 16, 32, and so on. Is our world complex, or is this just an illusion? This is a fractal tree. A fractal tree is an example of an object which seems to be very complex at the top. This is an illusion, however, because the structure of the tree results from repeating the same simple principle. A closer look reveals that the stem and the branches are continuously split into two when going upwards. This phenomenon is called bifurcation, which eventually leads to an apparent chaos. In nonlinear dynamical systems, bifurcation means period doubling. So our tree grows from the natural constants, from the Planck scale. As the system develops, there is the first period doubling, second, third, fourth, fifth, and so on. The top of the tree is present time. And there is a large number of period doublings, as we can see, we have seen already. At the top, there are many, many small crisscrossing branches. And what we do, we try to find the relations, physical relations between these small branches. But that's a very difficult task if we don't know that all these branches belong to different bigger branches, which belong to different bigger branches. And because we feel that this is also complicated, there are no clear relations between the branches. We need something that is dark, we need fluctuations, we need virtual things, and whatever. These are called free parameters. But this is a very well organized system, grows from natural constants and goes nicely forward. We can say that nature is economic. One simple physical process seems to create structures from small to large. This process is the period doubling phenomenon in nonlinear dynamical systems. And then, summary. We have analyzed observational and experimental data and found distinctive marks of the period doubling process, characteristic to nonlinear dynamical systems. The key finding is that the doubling process takes place in systems formed by 3 and 4 internal degrees of freedom. The period doubling process organizes the elementary particles into groups, creates the elementary electric charge from the Planck charge and gives it the right value, explains all measurable physical properties of the electron, which are mass, charge, and magnetic moment, explains all physical properties of the nucleons and the stability of these basic particles, determines the orbits and orbital velocities of the planets from the Planck scale, not from the Sun, connects the electron-positron pair, cosmic microwave background radiation, hydrogen 21 centimeter ratio, radiation, and the sunspot cycle, explains and predicts the quantized galaxy redshift. I must clarify a bit this last sentence. When I had found the equations for the velocity and played with numbers and the solar system, I read an article in Scientific American in December 1992 where Professor Tift explained his findings of these quantized galaxy redshifts, and he mentioned three velocities. I immediately noticed that these are exactly the same numbers that I had calculated with this period doubling phenomenon. So I sent a telefax to him and said that this extremely simple equation starting from the speed of light seems to yield exactly those redshift periods that you have observed. And Professor Tift replied me by telefax, we didn't have email then, that, oh yes, that's what it seems to do. And it seems to predict many more redshifts that I have in my drawer and not yet published. So we started to collaborate, and the Lehto-Tift equations were born in this way. So the period doubling process seems to create natural structures from small to large, from a common process-independent origin defined by natural constants. And that's it, thank you.
So thank you, Professor Lehto, very much indeed. So it looks that we are living in far more ordered universe than we could expect from the existing theories. Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, that is correct.
Okay. So then the talk is open for questions. So please go ahead. Okay. Adocha, yeah.
Yes.
So my question is, then do you think this could help us? Well, if you could say a bit more on that, how the structure of this table would look, and if that could be useful, let's say, to predict some of the existence of some other particles.
Oh, yes. Thank you for the question. My colleagues have very often asked me to draw a periodic table of the elementary particles, but I haven't done that yet. Sorry. But it can be drawn from the classification of the particles.
Professor Barbour.
Thank you for explaining a little bit, but I'm still a little bit mystified about these galaxy pairs. How are they identified? And secondly, if their redshifts have changed in 20 years, astronomers have got very good records of galaxy redshifts. Surely they must compare them with their and see that either they agree or disagree with Tift's thing. So perhaps you can answer the first question. How does he identify galaxy pairs? How? Because, I mean, all the astronomers see are just galaxies and their redshifts. They have really no other information.
I am not an...
How do you identify a pair out of that?
I think that they are reported in the catalogs of galaxies. I don't know how they are defined to be pairs. But this is common knowledge among astronomers that galaxies and stars are binaries very often.
That is because of their morphology, I think. I suspect if they're close to each other, they will exert tidal distortion on each other. So I imagine that might be the way that they do that. But what is then the phenomenon if we accept that there's a good way for astronomers to identify pairs of galaxies? Yeah.
No, the redshifts of the components of the pair are different, although they are physically connected. So I would like to add that.
That would then be relying upon possibly statistical chance. I mean, the.
No.
Well, I would, and it seems to me absolutely crucial to this is how the pair is identified.
Well, they are physically connected. If you scan with the 21-centimeter wavelength across the galaxy pair, you see that they are physically connected. And that is one indication of that it is pair. There are arcs that connect the galaxies.
It's only seen at 21 centimeter.
No, it can be seen in the infrared too.
Okay.
But anyway, the redshift, there is a redshift difference between the components, although they should be at about the same distance from us because they are pairs. That's why Professor Tift thinks that this has to do with some internal property of the galaxy. So the galaxies are energy systems, which depends on total mass of the galaxy. But of course they are moving around in the space, and that obscures, of course, the quantization. If all galaxies are plotted, we need to measure the redshifts for a system of galaxies. For instance, in our local group, the peaks of the distributions are very sharp. But Tift published a book of all his works last year, where all this is thoroughly explained. Professor Tift calls galaxies hyperparticles because they have their distinctive structures and properties. So this is property of fractals. It's the same for the small and the large and in between.
Okay, any other questions? Yes, please.
Thank you. Galaxies are energy systems. Will you please open that idea more?
Energy is frequency or period. And we showed that there are three intrinsic degrees of freedom within these systems, which means that there are kind of three independent energies which form a phase space volume, which is joules cubed. But because we observe joules, we need to take the cube root or geometric mean of the three energies, and then we get what we observe. But I refer to the relation between period and energy. So we see the period doubling or energy halving in this system. And this is not speculation, but I think that what I call energy is the gravitational energy of the system. But this is speculation. I don't know.
So, okay, I'm sure that you have been asked many times that what is the probability that this is just a coincidence that we fit those specific numbers?
For all this that I showed, yes, a statistician friend of mine calculated that the probability of coincidence is almost zero.
Essentially zero.
Yes. But not okay. Quite.
There's still time for one short question. So is there anyone having something important in your mind? Okay, then once more, thank you, Ari Lehtova. Very, very interesting this presentation.